Comrade Sampath, who is the president of today's meeting, all the leaders assembled on the dais, my brothers and sisters. I'm very happy to be associated here with the conclusion of the Tamil Nadu Untouchability Eradication Federation's conference. Social justice in our country is a very important agenda. The Communist Party of India Marxist believes that the struggle against social oppression and the struggle against economic exploitation, both are two struggles like 2 feet on which we stand. Unless both these feet start walking together, we cannot move forward. Therefore, true people's liberation is not possible unless we end the caste discrimination, we end caste oppression, and at the same time end the exploitation that is taking place in the economic sphere of the vast majority of our people. That is why we are the only party which combines these two struggles, and that is why I think the team Tamil Nadu Untouchability Eradication Federation is doing a wonderful work in this direction, carrying forward the legacy of this district in Thanjavur, where in 1950s, comrades like Srinivas Rao led the struggles against the landlords, uniting the scheduled caste and the backward classes and all these sections. And that was the thing of combining the struggles against social oppression with the struggles against economic exploitation, and the CPIM is determined to carry forward the struggle in order to liberate the people from exploitation. For over 7 decades, the country has given reservations for our scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. But even then, the situation has not improved even after 70 years. After 70 years, the attacks on the scheduled caste and the caste atrocities in our country have been growing. And they've been growing particularly because of the ideology practiced by the RSS, BJP and their central government. But mere reservations alone will not solve the problem unless economic empowerment is given to the socially oppressed. That economic empowerment will only come when we combine the struggles against economic exploitation, and that is the only way forward. And it is that way forward that the Marxist Communist Party is going to carry forward, and that is our solemn resolve to all of you, that my party will not waver or put any backward step in the direction of carrying forward the struggle against caste oppression till castes are eradicated, and the struggles for against exploitation till people are liberated. Both these objectives join together in our perspective. But what is under threat today, after the Modi government has come back after the elections, is that not only are atrocities against the socially oppressed growing, but the entire foundation of the Indian constitution is being undermined. Our constitution today stands on 4 fundamental pillars. 1, secular democracy. 2, economic self-reliance. 3, social justice. 4, federalism. Every one of this pillar is being undermined by this government, and unless we protect our constitution, the struggles against socially oppressed, against social oppression and economic exploitation cannot be carried forward. Therefore, we are part of a much larger battle today. We are part of a much, much larger battle today where we have to protect even what has been gained so far. That is being destroyed by this government, and that struggle has to be intensified. Otherwise, all the gains we may have had during the past 70 years, even those are being undermined. Today, even the question of reservations is being undermined by the economic policies followed by this government. Every sector in our country is being privatized. There's large-scale privatization across the board, including defense production, including the sale of our Indian railways, including the sale of our Air India, Indian planes. And this sort of privatization removes reservation. Once it is a private entity, there is no reservation in the private sector. That is a demand that the CPIM has been making in the parliament, and we are fighting on the streets all over India, and we will continue to fight for that. But what else is happening? reservation and privatization of education and new education policy that is coming now. That means the reservations in the schools and colleges, even that is going to be undermined. Privatization of health. Whatever little benefit the socially oppressed and economically exploited get through government hospitals, that is being completely undermined. Health, education, employment. We have the worst unemployment in the last 50 years in India today. And if employment decreases, what is the meaning of any reservations? And this is the reason why this economic slowdown that is taking place today is pushing crores and crores of new people below the poverty line. And the impoverishment of the people as a result of this Modi government's economic policies is growing, which means the socially marginalized, socially oppressed, their lives are becoming even more miserable than what they were earlier. That is why you have our social justice and economic self-reliance, both being undermined, which are fundamental pillars of our constitution. Now, what is happening to the other two pillars? We have seen what happened in Jammu and Kashmir, the manner in which this government has moved, that constitute a complete assault, a total assault on democracy, secularism and federalism in our country. Federalism is already under strain after the GST, after the manner in which the states are being treated today. Federalism is, the BJP is moving towards a unitary state structure, which is what the RSS wants, so that it is easier to convert our secular democratic republic into their conception of a fascistic Hindutva Rashtra. In order to do that, they require a unitary state structure, not a federal structure. And that is why their slogan, one country, one culture. One country, one, now they're extending this to various things. The Prime Minister said, one country, one election. One country, one tax. And the RSS slogan is Hindu, Hindi, Hindustan. One country, one language. And that is what is the, is also the essence in their education policy. The this sort of a imposing a uniformity on India's diversity is actually going to lead to a complete implosion of our society, which is dangerous for our future. Why do you say that what they did, how they did in Jammu and Kashmir is an assault on democracy, secularism and federalism of our constitution? How did they do what they did of reducing the status of one state into two union territories? India was 29 states earlier, now it's 28 states. And how was this done? The Indian constitution stipulates any effort to change the boundaries of any state must have the approval of the elected state assembly. Now, there was no elected state assembly that was dissolved by the BJP central government earlier. Instead of that, you had the central rule. First, BJP withdraws from the coalition government, leading to the fall of the state government. Then, when an alternate government is coming into place, they dissolve the assembly so that no alternative government can come. Then they put it under governor's rule. Then they put it under central rule. They hold elections to the Lok Sabha but not to the J&K assembly. If conditions were okay for holding Lok Sabha elections, why not for the assembly? And all this was done with the plan that since the state assembly is not there, the governor is taken as in proxy for the state assembly. And therefore, you divide the state into two union territories, take the approval of the governor and say that was done with the agreement of the state administration, and using your majority in the parliament, you actually reduce one state in India and reduce it to two union territories. This is what has happened, and this is the dangerous precedence against federalism and democracy. Tomorrow, any state in the country where the BJP is not the ruling party can be put under central rule, and that state can be divided into union territories, and that union territories will get the approval of the governor or which whoever central authority is, and that way their uniformity that they want in India can be achieved through this process of destroying federalism and destroying the states. And that is the danger we have, and that is the danger we all have to fight together. India is a country of diversity. The first article in our constitution says India, that is Bharat, is the union of states. That sanctity of that is being violated, and if we do not protect that, tomorrow every state will come under a similar threat where they do not have their government. They can divide up the state into union territories and that way destroy the unity and integrity of our country. That danger we must unitedly fight. The propaganda today, done starting from our Prime Minister downwards, what the RSS BJP are saying, that by whatever they have done in Jammu and Kashmir, they have integrated India. They have strengthened the unity of India. Why? Because they say they removed the special status of Jammu and Kashmir under Article 370. Special status is not there only for Jammu and Kashmir in the Indian Constitution. There are 10 different articles in the Indian Constitution. 371, 371A to 371B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I. All these are about special statuses for different states in our country. So this is a myth saying that only J&K had a special status. And that special status, even today, they say outsiders cannot buy land in J&K because of that special status. Today, outsiders cannot buy land in Himachal Pradesh, a BJP government. Today, outsiders cannot buy land in Uttarakhand, a BJP government is there. So if you say that you want to scrap that for J&K, why not for the states which you are have a government? This is the double standard they have. So it is not a question of eliminating the special status. It is the only state in India where the Muslims are a majority. So that is why the target for that, to say that this has to be eliminated, and it has a long history that I'll just come to. But therefore, this is a myth saying that this is an integration of India. You cannot integrate India. What does a country mean? There may be some of you who know Telugu here. There was a very big Telugu poet called Guruzada Apparao. He said, Deshavante matti kadoi, deshavante manushuloi. What he said was, a country means not its land. The country means its people. You can unite the land and alienate the people. That is not uniting the country. That is why when Vajpayee ji said, Kashmir is an inalienable part of India. What you have done now is Kashmir is an inalienable part of India, but Kashmiris are not an inalienable part of India. That is not going to unite our country. That is going to lead to greater problems. Today, they don't tell the correct history. When India became independent on the 15th of August 1947, the Dogra Empire of Jammu and Kashmir was not part of India. India became independent without J&K. It was when J&K ruler said he wants to be independent of both India and Pakistan. When Pakistan sent their invaders, which are known as Pakistani invaders, who came up till Srinagar, that is when Raja Hari Singh of J&K, he requested Indian army to come and help him to push back the Pakistani invaders. That could not have been done unless he was part of India. So that is how Jammu and Kashmir joins the India by signing the accession instrument in October. We got independence in August. In October, they joined the Indian Union under conditions. Those were the conditions that came as Article 370 that was incorporated by the Constituent Assembly that was already drafting the Constitution. So the special provisions that came under circumstances of this history. And even those special provisions, Only three central subjects were to be applicable to Jammu and Kashmir then. Today, 370 has been eroded so much before what happened now recently by the Modi government. Before the 370 has been eroded so much that instead of only three central subjects that are applicable to J&K, today 94 of the 97 central subjects are applicable to J&K before all this happened. So that is to say the Article 370 was only left in formality. The content was already eroded all this period, and therefore to use that as the excuse today is actually masking the real objective of what the RSS BJP want. The tensions between India and Pakistan over Jammu and Kashmir are well known. We have had two wars over that issue. And the idea was that after every war also, finally settlement is done through talks and negotiations. So we have been saying keep the channel of talks with Pakistan open. But then Pakistan was fishing in troubled waters in Jammu and Kashmir. Pakistan was sponsoring cross-border terrorism. And in fighting against terrorism, we said all of us are one. Question of fighting terror, that is non-negotiable. Terrorism is the enemy of our country. And that has to be fought by everybody. On that there is no dispute. But in order to stop these attacks also you need to discuss. But they say till they don't stop it, we won't discuss. Pakistan says till you discuss, we won't stop it. So this is going on continuing, and that is becoming, it continues to become a source of conflict. Even yesterday Pakistan took it to the United Nations Security Council. And we'll have to see what the international community has said. Yesterday it appears that they said that they will not interfere, but this pressure will be mounted. So all this situation has been created by saying that we are fighting terrorism. Terrorism is there, and terrorist threats are there from various quarters in India. Remember, Mahatma Gandhi was killed by the bullet of a Hindu fanatic. Indira Gandhi was killed by a bullet of a Sikh fanatic. Rajiv Gandhi was killed by a bullet of Tamil Chauvinist fanatic of LTT variety. So we have terrorist attacks from various quarters. All shades of terrorism have to be fought, and that is how we can unite our country. Instead of that, by trying to isolate one or the other in order to gain your political advantage of converting India into a Hindutva Rashtra and not a secular democratic republic, all this sort of problems are being created. That is why this government also betrayed their own promises. 3 years ago, a parliamentary delegation was sent to Pakistan after a lot of debate in the parliament. Then Home Minister Rajnath Singh was heading the delegation. I was a member of the delegation. We went to Jammu and Kashmir, to all the regions in Jammu and Kashmir, met with all the stakeholders there. We came back to Delhi, issued a communique where the government agreed on two things. One, immediate confidence building measures, that is the pellet guns won't be used, which blinded a lot of people and killed a lot of people. Like that, five confidence building measures. And the second promise, we will immediately start a political process of dialogue with all the stakeholders. This was announced by the then Union Home Minister Rajnath Singh. But instead of having a dialogue with all the political parties there or all the stakeholders, instead of stopping using the pellet guns, they have been used again now. What did the government do? No dialogue. For 3 years, nothing. And suddenly you send some tens of thousands of security forces there, militarily take over Jammu and Kashmir, arrest all the leaders, leaders of mainstream political parties who are part of India, elected members of the Indian Parliament. Farooq Abdullah, he was under house arrest and not allowed to come to attend this session. These are people who want to keep Kashmir with India. You arrested people like all of that, including my party central committee member and four-time MLA there. Muhammad Yusuf Tarigami. He is under house arrest today. And by creating this terror, stopped all communication. No cell phone, no internet, no land phones. Nobody knows what is happening in the neighbor's house because there's no communication. Curfew, you can't leave. You promised talks with all of them, and through talks you'll have a solution. Instead, if you do it in such a manner, what else is this but meaning a military takeover of the Jammu and Kashmir in order to achieve your purpose of dividing that state, taking away its status as a state, so that your Hindutva project can advance, because Jammu and Kashmir was always conceded by the RSS as part of the Akhand Bharat. And Akhand Bharat is what they want, in which case Jammu and Kashmir has to be ruled by Hindus, and that is why this whole thing is taken as a part of a larger conspiracy of the RSS agenda. I went to see Comrade Yusuf when I heard that he was under house arrest. I wrote to the governor saying that I'm coming tomorrow, and objective is to see him. He's not in good health. I'm carrying some medicines for him. No reply. I go there, and along with me, I take the CPI's General Secretary also, Comrade D. Raja. Both of us land in Srinagar Airport. No information prior. No information at Delhi Airport. But once we land at the Srinagar Airport, suddenly police comes in, picks us up, and takes us to a separate room. And when we say, what is happening, why are you doing it, is they say, senior officer will come and explain. Senior officer comes and says, you are not allowed to go outside into the city. I said, why? The judicial officer will come and explain. The judicial officer, district magistrate, comes, and district magistrate says, I have an order not to allow you. It will disturb peace. I said, it's my right to see the order. In fact, I should be given a copy of that order. Then they showed a copy, saying that I by name am not allowed to enter Srinagar because that is prohibitory orders. Then I said, prohibitory orders prohibit more than four people. We are only two people. How are you stopping us? Then they say, you're going there will provoke people, and that will create law and order problems. So this is where we were not allowed. And they said, we'll send you back by the next flight. We will buy the ticket and send you back. We said, no, we got our return tickets in the evening. We'll go by the same ticket. So we sat there and protest the whole day. But this is what is happening. And what do the people, the questions they ask? But then what are the people in the flight, in the aeroplane, when you're going, all Kashmiris going back to celebrate Eid with their families? They have not spoken to the families for a week. And in that condition, they in the flight, in the aeroplane, what are the questions they keep asking? Is India treating Kashmiris like Israel is treating Palestinians? Will the Kashmir Valley become an occupied territory like the Gaza Strip and the West Bank? Will it be a place where there'll be permanent sort of upheavals, the intifada, as the Palestinians call it? Why are you garrisoning us in prison, keeping us in prison? Now, these are difficult questions that are emerging, and that is what the people are talking there in the valley. By alienating the people of Kashmir, are we strengthening India's unity? Are we strengthening, redeeming the promises we made at the time of independence? And when the Muslims were fighting Pakistani invaders, when they came to Jammu and Kashmir in 1947, the then Praja Parishad, that is the earlier avatar of the today's BJP, Praja Parishad was saying that they were supporting the Maharaja, who said Kashmir should remain an independent country. Today they talk of unity of our country, integrity of our country. What they want is to convert India from being a secular democratic republic into their version of a fascistic, intolerant, rabidly intolerant Hindutva Rashtra. That is the ideological project that is currently being implemented. That is why today we must realize it is not a sectional struggle or a sectional demand on which we have to intensify our struggles. Today, the struggle for all Indian patriots all people who are patriotic to India, today those who love our country, must unite in the struggle to safeguard our country as we know of it for the last 70 years. The India that we know for the last 70 years is now under siege. The entire constitutional order, based on the four fundamental pillars that I spoke of, is coming under attack. Secular democracy and federalism, the latest example that of Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir. Economy, Prime Minister talks of 5 trillion economy by 2020. 5 trillion. Today your automobile sector is closing down. In many plants they're closing down because they can't, the production, nobody is there to buy. Lakhs and lakhs of people are losing jobs today. And the automobile sector was supposed to be the vehicle of India's economic growth. That sector is in the worst crisis ever. Our exports are the lowest ever in decades. Unemployment is the highest ever. So what is this 5 trillion economy for whom? Only for your crony capitalists? Only those who are making money under your rule? The Ambanis and the Adanis and the others of that sort? For the vast mass of the people, there is only misery. That misery is growing. And fourthly, the challenge is coming. And what is going to happen is worse. Today, journalists who are sitting here in the state of Uttar Pradesh have been arrested and they are behind bars. Why? Because they shared messages that were against the Chief Minister or the Prime Minister. Today, your right to expression is under attack, saying that it is against the interests of the state. You are being called, new labels have come up as saying urban Naxalites, and that these people have to be arrested. That means attacks on the fundamental rights. The fundamental rights are democratic rights, are human liberties. These are increasingly coming under attack. That is, anybody who dissents and disagrees with the government is going to be put under Sedition Act or taken an action against him or put behind the bars. This is nothing else but a sort of a fascistic authoritarian rule that is coming, a dictatorial rule, whereby no dissent will be allowed. So time has come again for us to rise together, to stand up in defense of our democratic rights and civil liberties. Otherwise, this country, as we know of it, cannot be saved today. That is why my final appeal to all of you is come. Let us all join together to save India today. We have to save India today so that we can change it for the better tomorrow. And if we are not able to fight these onslaughts, only sectional struggles will not help us. Yes, the issue of social oppression is part of it. The issue of economic exploitation is part of it. The issue of unemployment is part of it. Our livelihood is part of it. Our democratic rights are part of it. Our civil liberties are part of it. This is a struggle to save India today in order to change it for the better tomorrow. And that requires the unity of all patriots. All patriotic people will have to come together. And my party is committed, the Communist Party of India Marxist, to unite all the people who are committed to fight to safeguard India today into joint people's movements. And that is the appeal that I'm making before all of you, that please understand the gravity of the situation and let us rise like one man to save India. And that is what is required, and that is what the need of the day is. So with the confidence, like in the last elections, the people of Tamil Nadu united to ensure that the communal forces, BJP, will not get a single seat in the parliament from Tamil Nadu. Like that, you will all unite. You will all unite and show the path to the people of India, that this is the path we have to follow to save India, that all like-minded people will have to come together, and together we have to save India so that we can change it for the better. With this confidence that you will strengthen this resolve, I take leave of you once again. Thirumbi ellarkum vanakkam.